Hello students, welcome to the video lecture series designed for you. Today we are opening our second book of economics of your syllabus, Introductory Macroeconomics. The question is, why and when macroeconomics emerged? Or what was the need behind development of the subject macroeconomics? Although United States of America and other Western countries were highly industrialized with well-developed basic industries, electric power, means of transport and communication, banks, other financial institutions, yet there was persistent fall in their level of output, income and employment. The classical economist could not explain this phenomenon due to worldwide depression. It was against this that the well-known English economist J.K. Keynes wrote a book. Keynes in 1936, in his famous book, General Book of Employment, brought about a revolution in economic thought called the Keynesian Revolution. Keynes criticized the classical assumption of full employment and developed a new theory known as macroeconomic theory. Therefore, Great Depression of 1929-33 is the main factor which have contributed to the development of modern macroeconomics. Let us start with the meaning of macroeconomics. Between two major branches of economics, we have already studied the former, that is microeconomics, and now we start with the latter, that is macroeconomics. There are many questions that comes in our mind, like, will the prices as a whole rise or come down? Like, what would be reasonable indicators to show that the economy is going better or going worse? Like, is the employment condition of the country as a whole getting better or is worsening? Question like, what steps can the state take in order to improve the position of the economy? These all questions are dealt with in macroeconomics. These are the kind of questions that make us think about the health of the country's economy as a whole. Health of the economy is reflected by income. Let's see how the concept of income generates. In this book, we shall examine the working of a capitalistic economy, a free market economy. In a capitalistic economy, production activities are carried out by entrepreneurs. Here I want to tell you students that an entrepreneur is a person who exercises major control over major decisions. He bears a large part of the risk associated with the firm or enterprise. He may himself supply the capital needed to run the business, or he may borrow the capital. To carry out business, he also needs some natural resources, some variable resources like raw material, and some fixed resources like land. And most important, he need human labor to carry out production. After producing output with the help of these three factors of production, land, labor, capital, the entrepreneur sells this production in the market. The money that he receives is known as his revenue. Part of this revenue is paid out as rent for the services rendered by the land. Part of this income is paid to capital as interest, and part of it goes to labor as wages. The rest of the revenue after paying rent, interest and wages is the earning of the entrepreneur, and it is called his profit. These profits are used by entrepreneur in the next period to buy new machinery, to build new factories so that production can be expanded. These expenses which raise productive capacity are called as investment expenditure. Macroeconomics looks an economy as a combination of four sectors, namely household, firm, government and external sector. Let's explain the meaning of all these four. First of all, household. By household, we mean a single individual who take decisions relating to her consumption, or a group of individuals for whom decisions relating to consumption are jointly determined. Household also save and pay taxes. Now the question which comes in our mind is, how do they get the money for these activities? We must remember that these households consist of people who work in firms or government departments and earn wages or salaries, or they may be the owner of firms and could earn profits. Indeed, the market in which the firms sell their products could not have been functioning without the demand coming from these households. So, households are inseparable part of the entire economy. Now, the second element, namely firms. The production unit in any economy is called as firm. In a firm, as already discussed, the entrepreneur hires wages, labor from the market, employs the services of capital and land as well. After hiring all these inputs, he undertakes the work of production. His motive in doing so is to sell the goods and services in the market and earn the profits. In this process, he undertakes risk and uncertainties. After second sector, firm, third sector is government. Government is also denoted by the term state. The role of the government is framing laws, enforcing them and delivering justice. In many cases, government also undertakes production apart from the imposition of taxes and spending money on building public infrastructure, running schools, colleges, providing health services, etc. These economic functions of the state have to be taken into account when we want to describe the economy of the country. So far, we have described the major players in the domestic economy. But all the countries of the world are also engaged in external trade. The external sector is the fourth important sector in our study. Trade with the external sector can be of two types, export and import. The domestic country may sell goods to the market, these are called exports. And the economy may also buy goods from the rest of the world, and these are called imports. Besides export and import, the rest of the world affects the domestic economy in other ways as well. Capital from foreign countries may flow into the domestic country, or the domestic country may be exporting capital to foreign countries. Means macroeconomics is that part of economic theory which studies the economy in its totality or as a whole. It is the study of aggregates and averages of the entire economy. Such aggregates are national income, total employment, aggregate savings, investment, aggregate demand, aggregate supply, general price level, etc. Since the subject matter of macroeconomics revolves around the determination of level of income and employment, therefore it is also known as theory of income and employment. There is a concept of economic agents. Economic agents or economic units mean those individuals or those institutions which take economic decisions. They can be consumers who decide what and how much to consume. These economic agents may be producers of goods and services who decide what and how much to produce. These agents may be entities also like government, corporations, banks, which also take different economic decisions like how much to spend, what interest rate to charge on the credit, how much to tax, etc. So, students, it was all about the meaning of macroeconomics. Now, why macroeconomics is studied? What is the need of macroeconomics? I mean to say, our next topic is importance of macroeconomics. Basically, macroeconomics helps to understand the functioning of a complicated modern economic system. Macroeconomics helps to achieve the goal of economic growth, higher level of gross domestic production and higher level of employment. It is macroeconomics which helps to bring stability in price level and analyzes fluctuations in business activities. Macroeconomics suggests policy measures to control inflation and deflation. It is macroeconomics which explains factors which determine balance of payment. At the same time, It also identifies causes of deficit in balance of payment and suggests remedial measures. Macroeconomics helps to solve economic problems like poverty, population, budget deficit, unemployment, business cycles, etc., whose solution is possible at macro level only, that is at the level of whole economy. With detailed knowledge of functioning of an economy at macro level, it is possible to formulate correct economic policies and also coordinate international economic policies. Students, so far we have studied about the meaning and importance of macroeconomics. In our earlier book, we also have studied the meaning of microeconomics. Now it is the time to differentiate between the two, micro and macroeconomics. Whereas microeconomics is the study of individual economic units of an economy, on the other hand, macroeconomics is the study of economy as a whole and its aggregates. Secondly, whereas microeconomics deals with individual income, individual prices and individual outputs, on the other hand, macroeconomics deals with aggregates like national income, general price level, national output, etc. Thirdly, whereas the central economic problem in microeconomics is price determination and allocation of resources, on the other hand, the central economic problem in macroeconomics is determination of income and employment. Fourthly, whereas the main tools of microeconomics are demand and supply of particular commodity or factor, on the other hand, the main tools of macroeconomics are aggregate demand and aggregate supply of the economy as a whole. Fifthly, whereas microeconomics helps to solve the central problem of what, how, and for whom to produce in the economy, on the other hand, macroeconomics helps to solve the central problem of full employment of resources in the economy. Sixthly, whereas microeconomics discusses how equilibrium of a consumer, producer, or an industry is attained, on the other hand, macroeconomics is concerned with the determination of equilibrium level of income and employment. Seventhly, price is the main determinant of microeconomic problems, while income is the main determinant of macroeconomic problems. Eighthly, topics studied in microeconomics are individual income, individual savings, price determination, individual firms' output, etc. Whereas, examples of macroeconomics are budget deficit, balance of payment, external debt of India, money banking system, privatization, globalization, liberalization, etc. Students, remember that meaning, functions and scope of micro and macroeconomics are different, yet they are complementary to each other, yet they are interdependent, not independent. These two branches of economics cannot study in isolation. We can say that in spite of the difference between the two terms, there is no conflict between them. Still, they are interdependent. Someone has rightly said, as both foot are needed for walking, in the same way, both microeconomics and macroeconomics are necessary for the understanding of the functioning of an economy and for framing various policies for the economy. It all was about macroeconomics and microeconomics. Now, students, it is a time to wind up the chapter. Let's revise it. Macroeconomics emerged as a separate subject in the 1930s due to Keynes. The Great Depression had provided Keynes with the inspiration for his writings. It was the Great Depression which is responsible for the birth of macroeconomics. Macroeconomics deals with the aggregate economic variables of an economy, while microeconomics examines the functioning of particular sectors of the economy. That is, the main feature which distinguishes micro with macro is individuality or aggregate. Macroeconomics sees an economy as a combination of four sectors, namely households, firms, government and external sector, and all these four sectors of the economy work together. So, it all was about the first chapter or your second book. Have a good day.